CES can be a mixed bag, but between the robot invasions and AI takeovers, I encountered tech that really stopped me in my tracks. First, a solid-state battery claim so bold that even battery skeptics were doing a double take. We're talking performance numbers that sound impossible. 400 watt-hours per kilogram, 5-minute charging, and a 100,000 cycle life. And even though it wasn't officially part of CES, transit, unlike anything else I've ever experienced. No steering wheel, no pedals, no driver. Just me speeding down the Las Vegas Strip in a vehicle that was no demo. That said, most of what really caught my attention wasn't spectacle, but optimization. We're talking wireless power systems that charge your smart door lock with invisible light beams, windows that become noise-canceling headphones for your house, and a simple switch that could save you thousands on an electrical upgrade. Trade shows are always full of vaporware and empty promises, but if you dig past the hype, there are real innovations that could change how we live. So what were the highlights that are worth your attention? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Dreo. Now, I'll get to the big battery announcement later, but I want to kick things off on a different topic. And it's a little bit of a cheat because the first thing I want to call out isn't really one device or company, but a category or series of things that can all be bundled together. I'm talking about wireless power solutions for things that are in our everyday lives. And the first is a door lock. Yes, a smart door lock is on my list. Now, I've been using smart door locks for years and I love them, but the one thing I hate is having to change or recharge the batteries. And there's something that my wife always worries about. I mean, I do too, to be honest. What if the door lock loses power and you can't get back inside? Some smart door locks have solar cells built in, and Lock-In has made some of those models, but solar is intermittent. Now, to sidestep this, Lock-In developed Aura Charge, an infrared base station that you can place anywhere inside your home within line of sight of the lock within 4 meters, like on a side table in your entry hallway. Now, this 24/7 coverage means no more intermittency, and the lock still has an internal battery if the IR gets blocked for a bit. If you're like me, you might be wondering, is this even safe? The company says the IR frequency and power is eye safe with dual safety certifications from TÜV Rheinland and SGS. The new V7 Max will have Aura Charge, and the upcoming Vino Pro will be updated with it too. The latter is currently available for pre-order, and I might be doing that myself. Lock-In wasn't alone on the wireless charging theme, though, that I saw around the show. Tech suppliers like the PowerCast Corporation, Onio, and LV Energy are building the underlying tech that companies like Logitech could use to power their products. PowerCast has magnetic resonance and radio frequency harvesting that can wirelessly power keyboards, mice, and smart locks. Onio built an ultra-efficient microcontroller that pulls power from ambient sources like indoor light, RF, and Wi-Fi, so devices never need battery swaps. And LV Energy's wave harvester converts ambient noise and vibration into electricity for sensors in loud environments. It's wild stuff and could probably be its own video. Overall, there was definitely a theme of finding ways to keep our devices charged up and working without needing wires involved, or in some cases, even batteries. Next up is a brand I'm a big fan of, and one that I've used for years, and it's today's sponsor, Dreo. Their CES booth felt like a nerdy comfort lab. Their standout for me was their new Turbo Cool Misting Fan. It uses the same ultra-fine mist tech from their humidifiers, so you get a strong cooling effect without getting wet. The difference was actually pretty dramatic when I put my hand in front of the fan. I even stuck my phone into it to see if any droplets would collect on the glass, and nothing, just cool air. The Turbo Cool Misting Fan series is coming this April. They also had the Motion Sync fan lineup that speaks directly to my laziness. If you move around a room a lot, you know that it's annoying when the fan isn't pointed at you. With a gyro-controlled remote on the Turbo Poly Fan 765S, you can just gesture from across the room and have the fan swing and tilt right where you want. It can also quickly transform from pedestal to desktop use. And one model even raises and lowers in height so it can follow you from sofa to desk. Another Turbo Poly Fan uses millimeter wave sensing to lock onto a single person and keep the airflow on you as you move around. Now, all of this ties into Dreo's AI sensory lab and its artificial intelligence of things ecosystem. Think of it as your house anticipating what you want and adjusting in sync. You tell it the experience that you're after, and it automatically adjusts the TV visuals, lighting, humidity, and temperature to match. It's a glimpse of a home that doesn't just wait for your commands. Dreo AI delivers a home that intuitively understands you, turning scenario-driven intelligence into proactive comfort and healthier living. If you'd like to learn more about any of these products, click the link in the description below, and a huge thank you to Dreo and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now let's switch gears to EVs. Sort of. What if you only have 100 amp service to your home, but your EV needs a higher powered charger? You're most likely going to need a very expensive panel or service upgrade to 200 amp service, but you don't actually need that. Your amp service is just the cap for how much you can run all at once. If you've turned on your oven, microwave, HVAC, robot butler, and tried charging your EV all at the same time, you'd run into problems. That's where SimpleSwitch steps in to offer a clever solution to a big problem. You can install this to have two high-powered devices share a circuit and choose which device to prioritize. For example, if you're in the middle of charging your car as you're putting the roast in, the SimpleSwitch will automatically flip from charging your car to powering your oven. It all happens seamlessly without you having to do anything, and it costs far, far less than getting that panel and service upgrade. Now, living in a noisy neighborhood can sometimes feel like being held hostage by your own environment. Are you surrounded by traffic or constantly bracing yourself for the next passing train? You're probably gonna love this. Walls do a pretty decent job at blocking sound, but windows? Not so much. They're the weakest link in your home's sound barrier, especially for low-frequency noise, which is the exact kind notoriously produced by planes, trains, and automobiles. These frequencies usually slip right through the glass, but DeNoize has basically built the same kind of noise cancellation that's in your headphones, but for your windows. For dual-paned windows, which are pretty common here in the US, there are two connection points. Sensors attach to the outer pane, and the other piece of tech attaches to the inner pane. As sound waves make the outer pane vibrate, the system reads that signal and makes the inner pane vibrate to cancel out that sound. Noise cancellation is basically just inverting the sound wave and playing it back against itself. In this case, the pane of glass is the speaker. You heard me right. The representative I spoke to even said that you could play music from the window, although it would mainly be just the higher frequencies of the music that you'd probably hear. I did get to experience a demo of the technology applied to a small piece of ductwork, and it was pretty impressive to hear how much it actually reduced the sound. The demo device dropped the noise level by about 20 decibels. Now, this tech is still in development, so it's not available yet. However, it feels like the kind of solution that could actually make city living a lot less overwhelming. If you're in an apartment or a house that faces a street that's very noisy, this could genuinely improve the quality of your life. Hopefully, they can make some good progress on bringing it to the market soon. Donut Lab's solid-state battery announcement caught everybody by surprise. I got messaged by a lot of you. It was also the kind of the talk of the town with those of us that were there. Many of you were understandably excited, but dubious. And skepticism is definitely warranted for anyone claiming an all-solid-state battery with these performance metrics. 400 watt-hours per kilogram, where 250 to 300 is what you typically expect from a lithium-ion battery. Full charge in 5 minutes, 100,000 cycle life, where typical lithium-ion chemistries would be between 1,000 and 5,000. Operating temperature ranges from negative 30 degrees Celsius to 100 degrees Celsius. Most struggle as soon as you get below freezing. Lower cost than traditional lithium-ion. Now, this claim is unclear, but I'm assuming they're referring to nickel manganese cobalt lithium-ion here. And sourced from abundant materials that are available everywhere. I chatted with a few people at the Donut Labs booth for a while about the battery and the company's partner, Watt, who developed an EV skateboard platform that EV manufacturers can build on. Donut Labs had been developing motors for years, but the team also started developing their own all-solid-state battery in secret. When I spoke to the chief technology officer, he said they kept it a secret until they had something they could actually manufacture. Not an idea of a solid-state battery, but one that is real, working, and can be produced. It's going to be shipping in the Verge TS Pro motorcycle in the coming months. The company is claiming to have a factory capable of producing on gigawatt scale when spun up to full speed. Now, this is very different from what we've seen from other solid-state companies developing their systems in public, often to much of our frustration and impatience on how long it's taking. And what makes me hold off on popping the champagne is that there are no details about the battery itself. They wouldn't comment on the exact chemistry or method of production. Full stop. The reason is that it's proprietary information that they're not willing to disclose just yet, which I understand. And when I asked if they had any third-party validation that they could share, even if it was obfuscated for proprietary details, they said they're working on pulling that together to share with the public in the not-too-distant future. They didn't put a hard date on it, but it sounded like it would be a few months out at the earliest. My friend Ryan from the channel Zeroth beat me to the punch and has a fantastic breakdown on what he thinks it actually is. Ricky from 2-Bit Da Vinci, Ryan, and I had a pretty spirited discussion about this at dinner during CES. Be sure to check out Ryan's video, but I'm planning on doing a deeper dive on this down the road as I can get more information. Now, I'm keenly interested in what they're doing here, but for now, I'm going to keep my skeptic hat firmly in place. And before I get to my wild ride, there's one last honorable mention. Now, full disclosure, I have a relationship with Pila Energy, but this is not a sponsored segment. Pila Energy has developed an energy storage system that I've been wanting to see for a long time. If you want energy backup and independence, getting a whole home battery installed is expensive. If you rent, you're just out of luck. What if you could add batteries inside your home to back up and power specific things? No electrician needed. Well, Pila's modular system meshes together and works in unison to shift your energy usage to take advantage of things like time of use electricity rates. You can even pair it with your home's solar if you have that installed. So you can synchronize when it charges and discharges based on when you're producing excess solar energy. When I got my Enphase battery system installed, I couldn't get as much energy storage as I wanted because of local regulations. I'm excited to be able to drop a couple of Pila batteries into my home to increase how much of my solar I can store and use each day. It can grow with me as needed, and I can take it with me if I ever move. It also doesn't hurt that it looks fantastic and will fit right in with your home. But the best part is that it's going to get smarter over time with new features and capabilities. And for Home Assistant fans, which I'm one, you're going to be able to link into this too for your smart home. There's a lot more to cover with this, but that's for another time. Here's a few companies that I covered in previous CES videos that are worth revisiting. I covered Flint in last year's CES video and did a separate deep dive on them. Its team developed a fully compostable battery made from paper. The company has made a lot of progress in the last year because these batteries are now in production with multiple cell formats for different use cases. And speaking of partners, Flint is now working with companies like Logitech. The small paper pouch cell blew me away. It's fully compostable and can power IoT sensors and other low-power devices. It was so cool seeing them on display and being able to handle one. They also make single-use AA replacements. The aluminum case is fully recyclable, and the cell contents are compostable and biodegradable. And you'll be able to get your hands on a product made with their battery very soon. Nimble is coming out with a line of trackable travel accessories that are powered by Flint. Another company making progress is Amprius. It now offers a cell that is capable of 520 watt-hours per kilogram energy density, which is currently marketed towards the drone and aviation industry. These are cells being sold to customers today, so this isn't a future tech, it's here now. Now, while Amprius' solution has a premium cost, for the sectors that the company is catering, it's worth it. Weight is a key consideration, so paying extra for an energy-dense battery makes sense. I'm a big fan of Lutron and have its brand of smart shades all around my house. So when the company announced its new series of wood blinds, my ears perked up. Smart shades let you manage both light and heat. I built my own Home Assistant automation that factors in time of year, window direction, and outdoor brightness to control when shades go up and down. It's been taking a lot of work and trial and error to get it dialed in though. Well, Lutron just built a simplified version of this programming directly into the blinds. When you set up the blinds in the app, you tell it which direction the blinds face, like north, south, east, west, and then activate a special feature and the blinds will auto-adjust to filter or block the light each day. The company also showed off a bathroom fan switch with a built-in humidistat. It turns on the bathroom fan automatically if the humidity level ramps up to a certain level, and then turns the fan off when it's back down. This isn't a smart switch like you might be thinking. There's no app. Just swap out the switch and you're good to go. It's pretty nifty. Now before I wrap up CES 2026 and put it in the rear view, we need to talk about Zoox. I'm not new to autonomous vehicles. Back in 2019, I put out a video about my brother and I experiencing a Waymo ride. For years, I owned a Tesla with full self-driving, parentheses, supervised, and was super impressed with how good it's become. Granted, it wasn't true full self-driving, hence the parenthetical. So when I kept seeing Zoox driverless cabs zooming around while walking from venue to venue at CES, I just had to try them. When I think of the future of full self-driving cars, I don't imagine cars as we know them today. Why would you need everyone facing forward? You don't need a steering wheel or pedals. The design could be completely rethought, and that's exactly what Zoox did. You hail the car from an app similar to Uber or Lyft. The cab pulled up and waited for me. To open the doors, I tapped on an open doors button in the app and got inside.
This is wild.
I was greeted by a voice telling me to hit the closed door button, then to hit start when I was ready. After that, music started playing and we were off. And side note, you could select different music or just turn it off. The inside is basically like a giant box on wheels. There's two benches facing each other, so if you were out with friends or family, or this guy, you'd be facing each other to chat and not even pay attention to the fact that you're hurtling down busy roads in Las Vegas. Now, the best thing I can say about the experience was that it was completely uneventful, almost mundane. I think that's actually high praise for what this should be. Although there was one point when we were really booking down a major roadway, and I thought, if I crashed right now, this would be the last thing people would see of me. Now, this video is only scratching the surface of what it was like to explore CES 2026. I met an extensive cast of robots, some that barely looked functional. Despite this, it seems like we're heading for the normalization of household robots, probably on a faster timescale than we think. But they don't seem to be there quite yet. And of course, the mystical acronym of AI was slapped onto everything to the point where it's lost all meaning. Overall, though, I thought it was a really interesting show this year. But what do you think? Would you be interested in any of this tech? What were your highlights from CES? Jump in the comments and let me know. As I usually mentioned, you can also check out the extended cuts of my videos over on Patreon. And speaking of that, these videos take a team to make, a team of humans, no robots. Real research, real interviews, real feedback from experts, no AI slop. If that matters to you, Patreon support helps a ton. And a big welcome to new Supporter Plus members, about to butcher some names here, Pat Lenahan, Shaimam Shariar, and James Berbeski. And new producer, Jack F. Thanks so much for the support. The link's in the description below if you'd like to join. But honestly, just watching like you are right now is always awesome. Thank you, and check out my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined, where we'll keep this conversation going. Keep your mind open, stay curious. I'll see you in the next one.